Hi friends, welcome to lectures by Professor Shilpa Khatri Babbar. Today's lecture is on a very sensitive topic, which is primarily sexual violence against women. And we are here going to bust a lot of myths which are associated with sexual violence against women. Followed by this, we shall be doing a similar exercise towards sexual violence against children. Now, when we talk about sexual violence against women, it's very essential for us to understand what is the concept of violence. And to understand the concept of violence, we need to understand firstly that it's derived from a Latin term which is called vis. And in this particular understanding of violence, there are a couple of things that we need to actually focus on. Number one is there is a use of force. There is this notion of constraint which is there. There is this element of physical superiority. Now here I've consciously used the term physical superiority. However, let me put it across very clearly that superiority in terms of violence need not always be physical in nature. It could be caste-based, it could be race-based, it could be gender-based. So that physical element which I have consciously put in because of the fourth thing, which is on the other person. So there is this objective reality which I wanted to put across, and therefore I have put across this element of physical superiority here, but should actually not be treated as a restrictive understanding. It's not an exhaustive understanding. And of course there is vis-a-vis, violence is vis-a-vis another person. And the last important element is that violence is mutant. Now, what do I mean by violence is mutant? I mean that violence is not specific to a time, it is not specific to a space, it is not just devoid of temporality and speciality, it is also devoid of culture. So violence could actually take on different forms in different cultures. So for instance, if female mutilation is a cultural custom in a particular society, it is seen as an element of violence in another society. And how is it adjudged is very subjective. It is very cultural specific. And so therefore, it's very essential to understand that violence is mutant. The next slide will put across that how does the UN Declaration on Violence Against Women actually define it. And I'm quote unquote reading out Article 1 of the Declaration for you on the screen and for me on this another screen. And I read it as: any act of gender-based violence that results in or is likely to result in physical, sexual or psychological harm or suffering of women. And I'm actually going to come back to this concept of psychological because it's very essential. So psychological harm vis-a-vis women or suffering vis-a-vis women, including threats of such acts, coercion or arbitrary deprivations of liberty, whether occurring in public or private life. Now, why did I overemphasize on psychological? Because let's all face facts. And as mature individuals, as mature audience, please remember, and you will visualize this, that in every household, every woman is actually subjected to some form or the other of emotional and mental violence. And we actually read it as a part of normalcy because it's been engendered into us. It's actually been read into us, internalized into us, socialized into us. So this is the right moment for each one of you sitting at homes to get up, help your mothers, help your sisters, and to men sitting there, and maybe not my students from college, to those married men to help their daughters out, because we need to eliminate from our society all elements of psychological violence if we need to make our society a beautiful reality, a livable reality. When I get very carried away by this particular topic, I would now want to move on to an extension of this particular article. In fact, we move on to Article 2 of the Declaration, which speaks about physical, sexual and psychological violence as occurring at three different spaces. The first space is family, the second space is community, the third space is state. And when we talk about family, it could be marital rape, it could be incest, It could be non-spousal violence. So violence may be towards our in-laws, towards the elderly. It could be towards the daughter. Family as it could be dowry. So family as space of violence. When we talk about community as space of violence, we talk about intimidation in terms of workplace. We talk about eve-teasing outside on the roads, so on and so forth. And when we talk about state, then I have one beautiful case that I always share with my students when I do violence against women, and this is where state was actually involved. So there was this particular tourist, a Bangladeshi tourist who was here in India to visit Ajmer, and at Railway Yatri Nivas in Bengal, she was raped by the employees of railway. And there was a PIL which was filed on her behalf by Ms. Chandrima Das, who was a practicing advocate in Kolkata. And the Supreme Court very beautifully held that the writ jurisdiction of the High Court is wide enough to actually be extended to the realm of tort, and specifically granting compensation to the victim who had actually suffered personal injuries at the hand of the employees of the government. So this is where the role of space becomes very state becomes very, very significant. Now the point is that where does this violence actually come out from? Because it is not that our society was born with these kinds of mentalities. Where do we get those cultured mentalities from? Where are we performing those mentalities from? And this would be clear from the next slide, which says that there are several sources of violence. And one of the most important source of violence is cultural patterns. And when we talk about cultural patterns, there are certain traditional and customary practices, all unnecessarily, which have basically been induced to superimpose one's existence over the other. So there are certain customary and traditional practices. There are certain acts of extremism which are related to race, ethnicity. So you have this element of ethnocentrism which is actually coming in, wherein I am a superior race, and therefore it is as if I'm empowered to exercise exploitation on the so-called lesser race. So some form of justification which are actually rooted in the given cultural patterns. There are certain gender norms, as we've been discussing in part one and part two of gender, that there are certain specific norms which as if are stereotypical realities, are considered to be given as if they actually existed from time immemorial, but actually do not. And of course, widespread illiteracy. So sadly, what's happening is that these laws indeed are existent. At least today one can very easily say that laws are existent. But who is the ultimate beneficiary of these laws? It's not you and me. It's primarily those people who do not have access to those particular laws. And that is why I say PWDVA 2005 has the beauty in the fact that it is actually very accessible and reachable and permeable to almost the last section in the society. However, let me also warn you that the cultural patterns and the gender norms also contribute to a great extent to widespread illiteracy, because here illiteracy should not be read as a degree based literacy. It should be read as lack of knowledge, lack of education. The fourth is that there is this unfriendly process of law. So I'm constantly scared of the fact that what is going to happen when a distressed woman is actually going to the court of law. How is she going to be taken care of? Will it be sensitively addressed? Will it not be sensitively addressed? And if I eliminate the element of women here, so there are these series which I was watching during the lockdown process on criminal justice. And they actually reveal a lot of insensitivity that is inbuilt within the system, within the prisons, within the various establishments which are related to law. So the unfriendly process is what I'm talking about. I'm also talking about the gaps and ambiguities in laws criminalizing violence. So what is violence? How is violence defined? How much is violence and how much is not violence? So there is this very interesting social media platform called Agents of Ishq, and in that Aika versus Baika, if I'm remembering very clearly, so there is this element of a police officer, a police station, there is a space of police station where this police officer, there is a male and a female, and both of them boast that they want to take care of the larger society, and Lavani ko use kiya hua hai to put the things across, the dance form in Maharashtra, and where they say that we are there to protect the larger society. However, how they give a very conformist definition of what is violence and what is not violence. So it is something which is happening within your homes. Don't come out of your homes. It's going to speak very bad of the society to which you belong to, and so on and so forth. So maybe in my next slide or so, I put on for you about Agents of Ishq and Aika versus Baika. Weak law enforcement. So there are various ways in which we know that when law is there, the enforcement of law is not such that it is women friendly. So these are the various sources which actually encourage violence. These are the various sources which painfully encourage violence. And with this understanding of violence now, we move on to several myths. I think there are a dozen of myths that I have spoken about, and we'll be discussing with each one of you. The first myth is that victims provoke sexual violence when they dress provocatively or act in a promiscuous manner. Now, I have consciously noted down how much I have to speak to eliminate this particular myth, because as I've stated earlier, it makes me get carried away, and the lecture is going to exceed the time limit. The fact as against to this particular myth is that rape and sexual assaults are